Hello, everybody. Thank you for joining this session. My name is Thorsten Remmler. I'm working in sales and application support for our rotational and high pressure capillary rheometer. And in this talk, we want to show how battery slurries are flowing during the coating process and how we can adapt those conditions onto our rheometers. So if we look on a typical coating process for coating a slurry onto the electrode, we see that this is done by blade coating, slot die coating, or sometimes even with spray coating. So from a rheology point of view, the most interesting thing is how does the slurry flows during the time scale of the process, but also after this, when it's on the electrode, how does it level? How is the structural recovery? And before we coat the slurry, we want to know if it's stable. Yeah, is it in the same conditions like we prepare this? Will some particles settle down before we can process? So all these questions can be answered with rheology. Now, let us remind ourselves what we are doing. So we apply a force to a sample. In this case, it's a shear force, yeah, parallel to the surface. And if we divide the force by the surface area, we come to the term of the shear stress. So it's a normalized force. So this shear stress is acting now on our sample, on the battery slurry. And as you can see here, the sample starts to flow. So we get a displacement in the same direction like our applied force, and this displacement can be time dependent. So if you calculate the displacement by the geometry factor, it's the height of the slurry, the wet layer thickness, for instance, you can calculate a shear strain as a geometry independent term. And if the displacement is time dependent and it's increasing, also the shear strain will increase. And we can ask the question, what is the change in shear strain per time? That's called the shear rate. In simple terms, it's what is the speed of the battery slurry in shear flow divided by the layer thickness. And both terms, the shear stress and the shear rate, we will find in our Newton's law. We measure the inner resistance of our material against an outer force that's called the dynamic shear viscosity as the ratio of shear stress and shear rate. So there are four parameters to control. It's the temperature, it's the pressure, the time over which the forces and the displacements are acting, and the shear rate and shear stress itself. Yeah? How much is the force? How much is the speed? So that's the task then for our rheometer. Now, when we go on site to a customer, we try to calculate the typical process conditions and convert it into rheological terms like shear stress or shear rate. You see here for the three process conditions for battery slurries, the blade coating, the slot die coating, and the spray coating, you see how we can calculate shear rates. For the blade coating, it's really simple. Yeah, you take the relative velocity between the blade and the surface, the electrode, and divide it by the wet layer thickness. It's a little bit more complicated when it comes to slot die, where you process your battery slurry through a rectangular shaped die. It's 6 times the volume flux, so it's the amount of slurry which goes through the die per time, divided by the geometry factor. In this case, it's the width and the height of the slot die. And for the spray coating, you typically have a circular shaped die, a nozzle for instance, then it's 4 times the volume flux divided by pi radius cubic. So we try to adapt what is happening in reality, and then we go onto the rheometer and measure under these conditions our shear viscosity function. Now, when you calculate those terms you relate it to a blade coating, you will end up with shear rates typically being in the mid shear rate range around 1 to 100 reciprocal seconds. The slot die coating is typically a bit faster, so the shear rates are higher, from 10 to about 1,000, and spray coating is in the high shear rate region, so you end up between 10 to the 4, 10 to the 5, maybe 10 to the 6 reciprocal seconds. And it's clear that this wide shear rate range cannot be covered by a single rheometer, so we have our rotational rheometer Kinexus covering the low to mid shear rate range. Aside of the processing conditions, we can also look on the leveling behavior at low shears. And our high pressure capillary rheometer, our RH2000, can cover the mid to high shear rate region. So if somebody is doing spray coating, it's definitely the case that we need a capillary rheometer to cover that. Now, on the rotational rheometer, we place our sample between two plates. The lower plate is fixed and the upper plate can rotate, it's movable. And the distance between the upper and the lower plate is defined. At least we should have the gap size 10 times larger than the maximum particle size in our battery slurry to make the assumption that we can calculate continuum mechanical properties. And our Kinexus will now apply a torque, a force to the sample by means of a drive shaft supported by the air bearing and divided by the surface area of our geometry of the upper plate. We can calculate this shear stress and our position sensor will measure the angular displacement per time. So this is the angular velocity divided by the gap size. Then we can calculate the shear rate. So we have both modes of operation, like the process can be controlled, force controlled or speed controlled. So if the process is force controlled, we apply the torque to the rheometer and measure the angular velocity, or vice versa, if the speed is controlled in the process, we apply the angular speed and measure the torque. Now, those are typical shear viscosity functions of battery slurries in the processing region. So you see here on the x-axis the shear rate from 1 to about 1,000 reciprocal seconds covering the blade coating and the slot die coating. And you see in blue the shear viscosity function of one slurry showing a shear thinning effect. And in green, another battery slurry showing the increase of viscosity with increasing shear rate. Now, this is called shear thickening, and shear thinning and shear thickening are usually hard to understand. Therefore, I thought I'd show you an example. Those are two dispersions. One is shear thinning and one is shear thickening. So if you take a spatula and just pour it into the dispersion and then take it out, you can see, hopefully, it's flowing nicely. Yeah, it's like honey, yeah, mid viscosity range. And the other one is doing the same. I can take it out and it's flowing like honey as well. Yeah? So now, if I increase the shear rate now by taking the spatulas out with a high speed, you see the difference. See that? The left one, or from your perspective, the right one, is coming with the spatula because it's the shear thickening one. Yeah? It increases the viscosity the higher the speed is. And so I can apply the force and this is transferred to the beaker. Whereas the shear thinning will reduce the viscosity, so I have no chance by going upwards with the spatula very quickly to lift the glass. So you can imagine if you want to process this shear thickening material, it will not be possible because of the high viscosity. In worst case, it turns from a liquid to a solid on the machine. Yeah? You don't get any smooth finish of your film. You get a blocked die. Yeah? So that is what we are looking for the customer with the rotational rheometer. And this shear thickening especially needs to be avoided. Yeah? It happens always at high volume fractions of the particles, and it is a phase transition under shear flow. And when your volume fraction of the particles is higher than 50% of the maximum volume fraction, then typically you see the onset of this shear thickening. So people in battery industry, in the process, try to avoid this by changing the formulation, yeah, changing particle size distribution and shape of their active particles. Now, this is an example for spray coating. So here we see the high shear behavior of our material undergoing shear rates up to 10 to the 6. And you see here two stages of shear thickening. Viscosity is increasing at mid shear rates. And here where the material is processed, is sprayed. Yeah, we have seen the shear rates are really high. You see the increase in viscosity as well. So this coating cannot be sprayed. It will block the dye as well. We try to avoid it. Yeah, so customers looking as well in the high shear rate region. If there is any onset of shear thickening. It also creates hysteresis in the flow properties, so we want to avoid it, definitely. Right, if we have a more closer look on the microscopic and nanoscopic properties, we can relate particle size distribution and particle shape with the viscosity function of our slurry. You see here on the right side the viscosity versus the shear rate for the solvent, typically NMP. Then we add a binder, a polymer, to the solvent, so we increase viscosity. It changes the flow behavior from Newtonian to slightly shear thinning. You see that? And if we add now different types of carbons as a conductive material, we see a completely different low shear behavior. The carbon A we have analyzed with the morphology M4 from our cooperation partner, Malvern Panalytical. It has a worse circular. Yeah, the convexity of the particles is greater compared to carbon B, which you see here on the right side. And that increases the resistance of the battery slurry at low shears. And that is the region where the leveling takes place. So you can impact the structural recovery and the leveling behavior by analyzing the particle properties. Now, we also have a chance to make a prediction of the shelf life of the slurry, yeah? Sedimentation stability. That's the reason why we are looking aside of the processing conditions also to very, very low shear rates, yeah, where the sample is undergoing gravitational stresses. And then the decision is done if it's stable or not. So when we calculate the stress created by gravity just on a single particle in the slurry, and then look which viscosity the slurry has, we can calculate the settling speed. Yeah, so by assuming that the particles are spherical, we can get a rough estimate. It's really only a rough estimate of the shear stress by gravity. If you take this number, which is affected by the particle size, the radius, and the density difference between the particle and the matrix, and then you look in your flow curve, which viscosity did you measure for that gravitational stress, and then put it into Stokes' law to calculate the sedimentation or the settling speed of the particles, you can make a prediction how long the battery slurry is stable. And in the case of infinitely high viscosity, then you have a stable slurry because the settling speed is zero. Now, there is not only viscosity, there is another counterplayer. This is called elasticity. And also our customers looking on this elastic flow behavior in shear flow. And I would like to show you a little video to demonstrate this. If you steer in a battery slurry or in a viscoelastic liquid in general, you will see the following. By increasing the speed of the stirrer, the material is creeping up the stirrer against centrifugal force and against gravity. So there must be forces acting on the sample against gravity and centrifugal force. These are created by the elastic properties of the material. And to make a long story short, if we process our coating at certain speed, we should not exceed a critical maximum speed because then it gets ruptured. Yeah? That has nothing to do with viscosity. This is just the nature of the material storing energy. And this is a flow instability then, where you can't process, you don't get a smooth finish. Yeah, you get rupture, film rupture on the substrate, and that needs to be avoided. And we can measure with our Kinexus very nicely these normal forces, these normal stresses, force per area, to make a prediction what the maximum processing speed will be. All right, and finally, we know now what a high quality battery slurry should have for flow properties, yeah, optimum flow properties. How can we produce such slurry? Our colleagues from Netzsch grinding and dispersing, they have a machine, a planetary mixer type PMH, where you can dilute the binder in the solvent, you can pre-mix the dry powders, you can homogenize your slurry, you can even knead your high viscous paste-like slurries, you can produce under vacuum to avoid the inclusion of air bubbles, and this is suitable for a very wide range of viscosities. So you see, I think we have a very complementary product range, yeah, from the analytical side, as you have seen also from Eckhardt before, now the rheology side to characterize the flow behavior, and the colleagues from Netzsch grinding and dispersing can produce this slurry then with the needed quality. That's from my side. I'm happy to answer your questions later on in the Q&A session, so thank you very much.